It's my great pleasure to introduce you to this session. I am the session moderator, and my name is Ansara Piebenga, and my 15-year-old daughter had a combined kidney and liver transplant 14 years ago. So we've been navigating post-transplant life for quite some time, including school issues. And it is with a great honor that I get to welcome three very experienced speakers today. Brandon, next slide, please. Thanks. All are mothers of transplant recipients, and they all have extensive experience in the education field. Stacy Hillenburg's son, Ben, is a 9-year-old heart transplant recipient. He and his family live in Naperville, Illinois, and Stacy is on the board of transplant families. She has a master's degree in education and has been a developmental therapist in early intervention for 9 years. She has a certification in infant toddler brain architecture from 0 to 3. And before working as a developmental therapist, she was an early childhood special education teacher for 4 years. Welcome and thank you for being here, Stacy. Regan Reeder lives in Pittsburgh, Pennsylvania, and has taught special education for over a decade. She's the vice president for Pressing On, a nonprofit that exists to uplift and coach others in times of crisis. Regan earned a dual bachelor's degree in special education and early childhood education and a master's degree in special education. As a mom who's experienced her daughter's long road to recovery after liver transplant, she's passionate about linking families to one another in order to cope with their ongoing needs. Welcome and thank you so much for being here, Regan. And finally, Leslie Wyers lives in Columbus, New Jersey with her husband and her twins who are ages 17, Drew and Logan, and her daughter Kylie, who's 15. Logan and Kylie received living donor kidney transplants when they were 8 years old due to a rare genetic disorder called nephronothesis. Leslie is president of the Neph Hope Foundation and has served on the UNOS Patient Affairs Committee. And most recently, she's the co-chair of the Community Engagement Work Group at IROC. And she's completing her 29th year in education as a teacher, learning consultant, and supervisor of special education. Welcome and thank you so much for being here, Leslie. What an impressive group, my goodness. Without further ado, I'm gonna turn it over to Stacy. Next slide, please, Brandon.
Hi, so I'm going to be talking to you first about early intervention and then a little bit about special education preschool. So early intervention is a federally mandated program that falls under Part C of the Individuals with Disabilities Act. It is with children residing in Illinois who are under the age of 3 years old and their families are eligible for services if a child has one of the following: a physical condition which typically results in a developmental delay, a Department of Human Services determined eligible delay of 30% or greater. In different states, it may be greater or less than 30%. That exists in one of the following areas: cognitive, physical, communication, social, emotional, or adaptive developments, as confirmed by a multidisciplinary team, or a risk of substantial developmental delay based on an informed clinical opinion. That means a child was not able to be determined eligible under the first or second ones, but there could be a consensus of qualified staff based upon multidisciplinary evaluations and assessments that determine that if they don't receive EI services, they will be deemed eligible. When your child is referred for early intervention services, a team of qualified professionals will come to your home to evaluate your child. The members of the team are based on what your specific concerns are. There's always a developmental therapist on the team, and then any other therapist based on your specific concerns. So a speech therapist would be assessing speech concerns, a physical therapist would assess gross motor concerns, and so on. And after the assessment, the team will look at the scores to determine if your child has a delay of greater than 30% or a qualified medical diagnosis. And you'll receive copies of all of the paperwork that is generated. And if your child is determined eligible, you'll get a copy of the individual family service plan as well. It's always better to call earlier and get services started earlier rather than waiting. Next slide, please. So this is just a general way that the early intervention process goes in most states. You start with the referral, and anyone can refer the child that is close to the child. So it could be the pediatrician, it could be you yourself, If your child is in daycare and the teacher notices that there's like some speech concerns or something, they can tell you that they think that you need to refer to early intervention. And then you go on to intake where the service coordinator will take down all your information, medical history, prenatal history, what brought you to early intervention, all that kind of stuff. And then you go through to the initial evaluation, which is what we just discussed, where they're going to decide, do you have medical diagnosis? Do you have a delay? All those kinds of things. And then it'll determine your eligibility. Are you eligible? Do you maybe need to come back in 6 months? That kind of thing. After that will be your assessment and IFSP planning, where you'll get your individual family service plan, and they'll put down your goals, strategies, what are you going to work on? They'll develop all of that in conjunction with you, because it's all based on your priorities for your family. Once you go to IFSP implementation and review, this is where your team will start coming to your house. So whatever therapists are put onto your individual family service plan, if you have concerns about your child walking, you'll have a physical therapist coming to your house. If you have concerns about your child speaking, you'll be having a speech therapist coming to your house. It's all very individualized based on your family's priorities. And then it's reviewed every 6 months to see how your child is making progress, if any other services are needed, and have your priorities shifted in any ways. And then at the annual IFSP meeting, you will be once again evaluated to see, are there any new services that are needed, or do you need to decrease services, increase services? Maybe you're being seen twice a month and you need to be seen once a week. So all that can be determined at your annual IFSP meeting. And transition, when we're transitioning out of early intervention into early childhood, and that happens about 3 months before your child's third birthday, which we will go into more detail about that in a little bit. Next slide, please. So this is what the assessment format looks like in general. It can look a little bit different in different states, but generally this is what it looks like and what will be on the assessment. So, and this is at the initial and at the annual evaluations. So when a child is first assessed at the annual assessment and the initial assessment, the therapists are going to look at different areas. We take a detailed history of concerns, the medical history, why the child was referred to early intervention, how the child is acting during the assessment. Are they tired? Are they hyperactive? Are they clingy, irritable, all these kind of things. And then, is this typical for the child, or is this atypical? Because that can always go into, is this a reliable? Should we maybe retest on a different day? And then we look at the scores of the test, and we use those to get an age equivalent, which helps determine the percentage of delay. In Illinois, there are many determining factors in whether or not a child will qualify for EI. Percentage delay is just one of them. We also discuss strengths and weaknesses of the child and the family. Does the family have a good support system? Do they have enough to eat? Are they struggling to make ends meet? Is the child on a good schedule? All these things go into the clinical narrative to help us base our opinion on whether or not the child is going to benefit from early intervention. Next slide, please. This is what a general individual family service plan looks like. It may look, again, different in different states, but generally this is what is put into an individual family service plan. So when your team writes it up, they're going to write down what your family priorities are. So this is what you're going to want to work on throughout the year. So if you're concerned your child isn't walking yet, you might have that as one of your family priorities for your child to start walking. If your child isn't speaking yet, that might be one of your priorities might be for your child to start making sounds or start babbling, things like that. So that would go at the top in your family priorities. And then we would go on to strategies. How are we going to achieve these priorities? What are we going to do? And this could look like things like mimicking, mirror play, imitation of play skills, all these kind of things. And then who is going to be implementing all of these? Is it going to be the developmental therapist, the speech therapist, who is in charge of all of this? And then The last box is at the 6-month meeting, we're going to go over progress that your child has made and decide how much, if there needs to be any new services that are added, or has a child made enough progress that we can just keep these priorities, we can keep these strategies and goals and wait until the annual evaluation. Next slide, please. So there's many services available through EI. We'll just briefly go over a few of them. Occupational therapy, which is for children with fine motor delays. This is how they use their hands, their fingers to develop things. It's also for children with sensory delays. The occupational therapist can take care of all of these things. Developmental therapy, we look at the child globally. So instead of a specific area, we look at all of the areas and figure out a different play skills to help the family with all of their needs. And we also help with parent education in order to let the parents know what is developmentally appropriate and what might be a red flag that needs further evaluation by one of the other specialties. The physical therapist is in charge of gross motor skills. And this is how your child walks and jumps and uses their legs, all these kinds of things. And they can help you build upon the skills that they have and work on those throughout the week. Next slide, please. The nutritionist is in charge of your child's nutrition, how the gaps in the nutrition might be affecting their developmental progress. The speech-language pathologist is in charge of expressive and receptive language progress or delays. They expressive language is the way your child communicates, either through words, gestures, signs. Receptive language is what your child understands about the world around them. They also have knowledge of feeding and swallowing disorders. So this is sometimes helpful after a child has had a transplant and they might be on a G-tube or an NG-tube. And they are having trouble learning how to eat again. This is where a speech language pathologist could come in and really help. Social workers are also very helpful in early intervention. They can provide many community resources. They can be very helpful in supporting families with different behavior issues or just as another person for any issues the families are going through. So they're very invaluable in early intervention. Next slide, please. Okay, so where we get in early intervention services, usually before COVID, we would always have early intervention services in the natural environment, and we still have it in the natural environment, but it just looks a little different now. Early intervention can be performed in the home, the daycare, at a library, shopping center, or any other places that the child would naturally be. But because of COVID, we can't really go to libraries anymore, and most daycares are not letting us in. So it does look a little different. We are doing a lot of early intervention over video visits. Some of us are going back into homes, which actually is on the next slide too. So next slide, please. We'll go over that in that one. This one shows us in a little more detail what EI looks like during COVID. Because now we have a lot, it actually depends on different states. Different states have different regulations, but in Illinois, we for intake, different child family connections have different rules, but for the most part, their intake is being done over the phone or via live video visits. They're not really doing intake in person. The evaluations and IFSP development. The evaluations are being done both via live video visits and in home. So you might have one therapist that is on video and the other one in the home so that you don't have to have different therapists on different days every single day of the week. But the IFSP meeting is always done via video visit or phone just because we can't have all of the therapists in the same room at the same time because of COVID rules. This might look different in different states that are more open, but that's how Illinois is doing it right now. Direct service we are doing via video visits and in the home. So we have therapists that are going in the home, but we cannot have co-treats right now because two therapists cannot be in the home at the same time. So it just depends on what the family is comfortable with. If they're comfortable with having a therapist in the home, then that's perfectly fine. And if the therapist is also comfortable with that too. If not, we do via video visit. In the childcare setting, it depends on the childcare setting. It's a lot of them in Illinois do not want us coming in. So we have to just do therapy with the child either before or after they go to school. Transition meetings also depend on the school district. Some of the transition meetings are happening via video visit, as well as the evaluations are happening via video visit. Some are happening in the actual school. So it's very much dependent on each different setting. The one thing that is consistent is you do have to have an evaluation and you do an IEP meeting. They can't just say, because of COVID, we're not doing that. If you request an IEP meeting and you request an evaluation, they have to do it somehow. Either LVV or in their school district. The medical diagnostics in Illinois are being performed both live video visits and in person. So it just depends on which hospital you go to, how they're doing it. Next slide, please. So transitioning from early intervention to preschool. If your child was in early intervention, in Illinois, this is how it works, but it may look different in other states. At 30 months, you will be asked to sign a consent to be referred for an evaluation to your local school district for special education preschool. If you do consent, this is when an individualized education program or a 504 will start happening. If your child was not in early intervention, then you can self-refer to the Child Find Act. Next slide, please. And then 3 months before their third birthday, when they're in early intervention, they will have the transition meeting with the school district and the service coordinator. All therapists are invited, and anyone that the parent wants to come with them for support is invited. But typically, it's usually just the parents and the service coordinator at this meeting. And then they will set the time to do the evaluation, which, like I said, they have to do the evaluation. They cannot just say no. And they will see whether or not the child qualifies for early childhood services. The school does take into account our reports, but ultimately it's all based on what the school's evaluation finds that is going to say whether or not they qualify for early childhood programs. Next slide, please. So there are many options that can happen when a child is transitioning from early childhood or from early intervention to early childhood. So it doesn't always have to be just they get a special education program. It could be that the early childhood team finds there are not enough delays for them to go into a special education program, and they recommend they go to a private preschool or pay to go to the public preschool because they've just made so many gains in early intervention. And I have actually seen that happen many times. They could also find that the child doesn't have delays that warrant a classroom, but might still need just some help with speech or fine motor skills. And they recommend that they come to the school district once a week or twice a week for those services, which I've also seen that happen. They also might decide that the child needs a classroom placement, but in a blended program where there are children with IEPs and without IEPs. And this could be for a number of reasons, such as they have a speech delay that warrants a classroom placement, or they might have a few delays like in fine motor, gross motor, and speech, but they don't need a self-contained classroom placement. They also could find that the child needs a placement, but in a self-contained classroom where this is a much smaller classroom with about 10 kids, two teachers, two aides, lots of adults in there. And this could be because they have significant health needs where they need all of that adult attention. Or it could be that they have many different delays. The one thing to remember is that this does not mean that they will stay in this placement forever. The IEP can be fluid. If they find that they've made gains, they can always move up to the blended program or any other of the options. It doesn't have to be that they stay in the self-contained program forever. Next slide, please. So you'll notice the EI versus early childhood, they look a little different. They have some similarities, but they also look a little different. Parents going from early intervention into an early childhood program will notice that EI is very family-based. So we focus on what's the family's priorities? What do you need to make your routines and your daily activities go smoother? How can we help you help your child to get through your day as smoothly as possible? And all of this is based, of course, on your child's needs. When we write the IFSP, we write down all of your family's priorities and your strategies to achieve these priorities and what team members are listed. And all team members be in communication with each other just to make everything go as fluidly as possible, make sure that everything is consistent and all the goals are carried out. Family members are the ones taking care of the child, and they're the ones carrying over the strategies during the week after the therapists leave. This IFSP is reviewed every 6 months, and at the 1 year mark, an annual evaluation is done by every therapist on the team to determine what services and frequency of services are needed. In early childhood, which is the preschool years, you have an IEP, which is the Individualized Education Program, which will be discussed in detail in a little bit, but whereas the IFSP was family-centered, the IEP is educational-based, and it's based around what educational goals the child will achieve during the school year and how they will achieve them, as well as who is responsible for help facilitating each goal. So if they have a speech goal, the speech therapist is going to be in charge of implementing that goal. A fine motor goal, we'll have the occupational therapist implementing those services. And the special education teacher will be overseeing the IEP plan as well and implementing all of the goals throughout the school day, as well as communicating with all of the team members. Next slide, please. This is just a little graphic about the differences between the IEP and the IFSP and what are some of the differences in there. And there's also a link at the bottom where it goes into much. I don't know if you want to copy that down or anything, but we also have it at the end in our resources package. So you can also see it there. But there's just like just some similarities and differences there. And then the next one is Regan.
Hey everybody, can you hear me okay? Okay, great. I'm Regan. Like she said, I'm in Pennsylvania, so we're going to highlight a lot that every state is different. So just so you guys know, I'm coming from the perspective of Pennsylvania. You can go to the next slide, please. So just to summarize, there are many programs available for school-age children. There are no-cost public school programs that are federal mandates to help your child have a safe, successful, and enjoyable school experience. These services range from helping your child catch up on schoolwork they've missed, to managing fatigue, home tutoring, learning before and after transplant, and they include things like individualized health plans, Section 504 plans, and individualized education plans, or IEPs. Next slide, please. We're going to start with the IHP, which is an individualized health plan. In a few minutes, I'm going to talk about a document that's available for transplant families. And in it is a glossary of all of these crazy acronyms that we as special education teachers use like a second language that mean absolutely nothing to the general population. And so we tried to define those for you here in this session, but we also have a glossary available to you. So keep your eye out for that as we talk about these things. But we're going to start with what we would consider to be the least restrictive plan. And the federal mandate is that we have our students in the least restrictive environment. That means that they have the least amount of supports in place. We don't want to pull them more than we need to, but we also want them to be fully supported and safe and healthy and successful in the school environment. So one thing that most transplant kids may have is an individualized health plan. And what is an IHP? This is what something that describes the student's medical, social, and academic issues. It takes everything into consideration that might affect them in the school day, like the need for a nurse or an aide, a special dietary plan, a medicine schedule, an emergency plan. Where would your child need to go if they needed to call an ambulance? We can specify all of those things in advance in conjunction with the school nurse and the transplant team. Next slide, please. Another thing that's available is a Section 504 plan. And we have in this document I'm going to discuss in a few minutes, we have samples written of individualized health plans, emergency plans, Section 504 plans, and IEP things that might be specific to transplant kids. But a Section 504 plan, it makes sure that a child who has a disability defined by the law receives the accommodations to help them be successful and participate safely and have the same access to education as other students. These accommodations are on a broad spectrum. They could range from home tutoring to extra time to complete homework. Really, what the plan exists for is to help eliminate misunderstandings. So the person who would be in charge of a 504 plan, you'd want to talk to your building administrator, like the principal, who would work with someone like a school guidance counselor and a 504 committee within your district to help get something like this set up. They do not have to have a disability defined by IDEA, which is the federal law for disabilities, but we'll talk about that with an IEP. A 504 plan is actually what I'm personally looking at for my daughter who's going into kindergarten next fall. So I'm a special ed teacher, but I'm also a nervous transplant mom who's sending my child to a school building for the first time. And so when I'm looking at this right now, I'm in these shoes. I'm thinking about what is best for her. And right now we're thinking of a 504 plan where we can discuss what she'll need throughout the day and make sure that she has what she needs. Now, she very well may need an IEP later, but again, we're going to start what we would consider in the least restrictive placement. And if we need to add more support later, we can do that. Next slide, please. So in order to be eligible for a 504 plan, a student must have a disability that limits at least one major life activity. And these are not limited to, but may include some of the following. And we highlighted the ones that may be most common for a transplant child, something that might affect their learning, eating, concentrating, thinking, their working ability, and it affects major bodily functions such as the immune system. So obviously all of our children who have had transplants are immunocompromised. And this is where we can put things in place through a 504 that can help protect them in the school environment. You'll discuss that again with your building principal and your transplant team. Next slide, please. The IEP, which is the bane of our existence as special education teachers, but they exist specifically to help children with disabilities provide specialized instruction and services as defined by the law. It is a legal agreement between parents and a child's school to address their unique learning issues and meet their educational and academic goals. So this is when we would look at something like with my own child, we're going to start with something like a 504 plan to make sure that she's safe and her medical and health needs are met. But if we start to see that those types of things are impeding her academic progress, which we haven't seen quite yet, then we would want to consider an evaluation and potentially qualification for an IEP. And so, you know, as I've talked to these other ladies in preparation for this as moms and as special education teachers, we have to be careful that we don't decide in advance what our child does or does not qualify for. So we have to go in with the same open mind as everyone else that we want to start with something and add more services as time goes on. Next slide, please. So let's say that our child is struggling in the school environment and maybe we're not exactly sure what we need to do or how they might qualify. Like I said, in order for a child to have an individualized education plan, they must have meet the criteria for one of the 13 disability categories defined by IDEA, which is the federal law for students with disabilities. One category is OHI, or other health impairment, and this may be what most transplant kids qualify for. Now, some may have autism, they may have a specific learning disability, they may have more than one disability category met. But an OHI or other health impairment means that they would have limited strength, vitality, or alertness, and maybe they're overstimulated, and it affects them academically. This could be due to chronic health problems, heart conditions, nephritis, all of the things that may affect some of our transplant kiddos may be a disability category that they would qualify for special education. All right, next slide, please.
And I think
Leslie is going to take over.
Thank you, Regan, for doing such a great job. And I think even I was perusing the Q&A, and I think hopefully we'll answer some of your questions in this. So Section 504 is under the American Disabilities Act, and IDEA is the special education public law, but both of them are under the Office of Civil Rights. And we do have a fabulous link at the end, which is from the Federal Department of Education. And you've heard us all say that different states do things differently, but there is some very underpinnings that run through that are federally mandated and have to follow the same. So I do, you know, even though we're all from different states, which is amazing, if you do go to the federal Department of Ed document at the end, you will see that there a lot of these are very similar in all the states. They need to be free of charge. Parents can request a 504 plan or to be considered for an IEP. A parent's request is taken very seriously, and there are procedural safeguards for you and that have to be followed. Services are available at all institutions that receive federal funding. However, private schools are not required to offer these educationally based services, but there are some elements of 504 that do need to be offered in private institutions. They do provide accommodations to help students with disabilities, and they also both provide needed directions to care for students who have undergone transplantation. Next slide, please. So how are they different? So the biggest difference between a 504 plan and an IEP is actually based on programming. And I think Regan did a nice job of explaining that it also has to have an educational impact. So 504 plans provide equal access to the educational environment. They do not have to have goals and objectives in which students have to measure progress, which is another part of the slide that we have highlighted under 504 plan. It is a civil rights law, like we were talking about. There's different eligibility requirements. So you don't have to have a medical-based disability to qualify for a 504 plan. Previous slide was taken that shows you just have to have an impact in one of those areas of a major life function. And then also what the plan provides for are accommodations to kind of level the playing field. That's a very common phrase that you will hear. It does not have to relate to academics. You can have a 504 plan because you broke your right hand and you're right-handed and you can't write, and it's a short-term 504 plan. Children who have gone through transplantation definitely qualify for an individual health plan. That's a no-brainer that they are afforded that opportunity. A 504 plan under the American Disabilities Act typically would be the first step, like Regan was talking about. And like I said, I have two children with transplants, and my one son, he had an IEP since early intervention and turning three, and he's 17, and then he has an IEP. My daughter, we started when she had her transplant with a 504 plan. And then after having that for a couple years, she did need a higher level of care, and we moved into the IEP. So I think, Regan, spot on in saying, you know, we start with the least restrictive of what our children need, and then we adjust based on, you know, what we see and the data that we collect. What I also want to get back to is for the IEP, you need to have a program. So for an IEP to be in place, there needs to be a specialized program. You have to fit under one of the 13 disability categories under IDEA. And typically, if you're just talking a student or a child with a transplant, other health impaired is usually, you know, the way to go. You have to describe how that disability affects the child's ability to learn in general education classroom. And then every IEP is different. So again, I have two children with transplants, and they both have IEPs, and both of their IEPs are incredibly different. And when we talk about their ability to learn, it doesn't just mean academics. It means, do they miss school a lot because they're frequently absent? Is it that they're fatigued so they can't do as much and cover as much material as their peers? So when we say their ability to learn, it doesn't just mean academics. It could also mean the ability to learn like a typical student with fatigue factors, absenteeism, things like that. The other thing I did just want to, didn't want to throw it out here. Next slide, please.
Okay, so we're going to talk about how we know if your child would need a 504 plan or an IEP. I think we've covered it pretty well that a 504 plan is less restrictive, but this flowchart is available in a link at the end of the presentation. The basics of it are that we define the student need. If that disability affects them educationally, we're going to evaluate more towards an IEP, as opposed to if it's limiting one of the life activities or one of the medical things, we may go more towards the 504. So those this chart is at the end of the presentation as well. The goal of both of these are to provide children FAPE, which means free appropriate public education. And you may hear that word thrown around. The goal is to provide them with a successful and safe educational environment. Next slide, please. So this is the packet I was referring to previously. This was created through the Starzl Network here in Pittsburgh. Dr. Starzl did the first pediatric liver transplant here in Pittsburgh. And the Starzl Network exists to provide resources for families of transplant patients. Now we are geared more towards liver transplantation, but this guide guaranteed is good for any parent who's navigating the school system with a transplant family. You can find it at this link. It's also going to be provided at the end. I really was honored to work with the Starzl Network. We were sponsored by the American Legion to create this resource, and I wrote it over the past year in conjunction with several school districts and other transplant families. It includes sample IHPs, individual health plans, sample 504s, sample emergency care plans, and it's very comprehensive. You're going to look at it and think, I don't even know where to start. You're not going to need all of these. You can pick and choose from it. You don't have to word it the way that it is, but it's just to help you have a guide and an idea of what a school district may be looking for. So I tried to do this from the parent lens and from the educator lens to think of what districts may be looking for. Again, you won't need all of it, but you can definitely look at that. Next slide, please. I picked a couple of things to highlight here in. And one of the things that I created for this was a beginning of the school year checklist. I'm a list person, and it helps me to know that I have everything in place. And it just gives you a list of what you may want to think through and have provided for your school district. Again, you're not going to need all of them, but it does include things that you may need if your child has a behavior plan. There's a reinforcer checklist. My child, for example, has very strict dietary restrictions. And so there are certain things she should not be given as edible reinforcers. I want my school district to know that. And so there are reinforcer checklists that you can complete to give your teachers ideas of what would be good or non-acceptable. Field trip plans, things like that. And again, the glossary of all of our crazy special education language is available in that as well. So I just encourage you to check that out on the starzlnetwork.org under resources. Next slide, please. We're going to give you just a really brief overview of some accommodations that may be beneficial for children who have received a transplant. We're each going to share a couple that mean the most to us. Again, this is just a starting point. Your child may need one of these, none of these, or all of these. So these are just to give you a brief idea. I'm going to share a couple, and then Stacy is going to share a couple as well as Leslie. So for my own here, I'm really focused on my child will probably need a specialized diet plan. I need to know what she eats every day. So how is that going to look in the school environment? I may need a lunch aide or someone to just keep a list for me or make sure she doesn't dump her lunchbox. Those are things that we need to have in writing, as well as individual snacks. In the classroom. Another thing would be nursing care. We may just want to make sure a school nurse is on site all the time, or maybe it needs to be a one-on-one nurse. There's just a big spectrum of nursing care that you want to discuss with your school district as well. And lastly, adapted assignments and assessments. Things may be modified. Maybe they need more frequent breaks because of their level of fatigue, or maybe they need extra time in order to complete it, or maybe they need less answer choices because they have a specific learning disability. The accommodations are a never-ending list on a spectrum, but these are just a few to give you an idea. And then Stacy is going to share a couple that mean the most to her.
Yeah, so we find that with my son having a heart transplant, that the emergency folder in the office and with his teacher is really important. It has all of his medications, all of his allergies, his latest EKG, his latest echo, the name to his cardiologist, and the name of his transplant hospital. So if he goes to any other hospital that call for any information, our names obviously, and the name of another emergency contact, so in case they can't get a hold of us really quickly. So just so if he ever was in an emergency, that the EMS people would know, like, okay, we're not going to give him albuterol, for instance, and we'll give him Xopenex instead. So it's just really important to us that that goes with him wherever he goes, just in case he's ever in an emergency. The other thing that's really important to us is communication between all of his teachers on any contagious illnesses. If somebody in his classroom has like chickenpox, for instance, we want to know right away, because if he's exposed to that, we need to get him down to his transplant hospital right away to get immunoglobulin and to get antivirals for the next month, because he can't be vaccinated against that. So it's really important for him to get antivirals really quickly so that he doesn't get full-blown chickenpox. So those are just a couple that are just really important to us.
Next slide, please. So, like I've shared, I have the teenagers who've had longstanding transplants. So some of these are very relative to high school and an IEP or a 504 for older students. Some things that you have to think about are most high schools have attendance policies and things like that. And our kids go to labs a lot, or they have doctor's appointments. So that the student may participate in extracurricular activities if they're absent from school due to doctor's appointments. A lot of, attendance policies require you to be in for a half day or something like that. And if you're traveling, just to your transplant center, it may be an all day doctor's appointment, with a lot of us already know that. I also want to highlight that, again, I have two very different children. So my son, and Regan and Stacy have heard me say this, my son, if you ever took him out of physical education, gym, he would not be happy, because it's pretty much why he would go to school. So he has an accommodation about having certain protection for when he was in PE. My daughter, on the other hand, could live her rest of her life never, ever, ever having physical education class. And so she has self-limited in PE. Seriously, though, she is much more, she has anemia, she battles some of the side effects of fatigue, she's nauseous a lot. So she has some more physical responses to her medications and to her transplant than my son, who's like a tank. But that just highlights the point that even from one family, you can have very different accommodations, because it's what's appropriate for your child and what your child needs. The other thing, and I'm going to highlight the custodial team. This actually it wasn't something that I was asking for, but it was from a whole team that our facilities director came in, and he offered, and this was prior to COVID, where everybody has, one-to-one devices, and he would have his cleaning team sterilize the in-classroom computers, and they were sanitized every night for my children, and they were dedicated. And that was just put in, and it wasn't something I asked for. It was something that they asked for. We also had a situation where the team brought in, I think, the food services director. And so she kept some extra water bottles and some other things separate and had them on site. So I just kind of try to give in some out of the box thinking, that when we say like our IEP team or our 504 team, the school is really a microcosm of a community, and there's all these different people who are willing to help. So just kind of thinking out of the box to see who can help where. Next slide. Okay, and I think this is actually a question. So I'm going to talk now about transition from high school to college, which I know scares so many people who have little kids to even think about this, and it scares me, and we're almost there. I want to preface this by saying that I am going to speak about high school to college, but I am in no way, and my husband's also an educator, I do not think everybody needs to go to college. I am a big proponent of trade schools and vocational technical schools as well, but for this slide, I am going to talk about college, and it's something that I've spent, I've been a case manager and for the last 10 years at the high school level, so I've been doing this a lot. So when we're thinking of kids who've experienced transplantation, thinking about going to college. Most colleges, right, typically want your college boards, your SATs or your ACTs. There is a way to apply for accommodations. And you may think, oh, well, why would my kid with a transplant need accommodations? So on this slide, you can see that this is coming from the college board, which is medical impairment. And an example of an accommodation or a need for something would be extra breaks, because sitting for extended period of times is something that is hard for someone. You please understand, I've proctored SATs, any kind of irregularity, like if a student has to get up and leave the room, their test is indicated that there was an irregularity, and College Board could actually void the test. So you don't want that to really happen, where your child is already, they've prepared, they go to take their SATs, the 3 hours or whatever, 3.5 hours. And, you know, they need to leave the room before their break is actually given. They need a drink or whatever. So, you know, I do encourage you to think about applying for accommodations. And we did put the links on. ACT accommodations is a different company. You have to go through their way of doing it. And SAT is through a company called College Board, and you go through their ways of doing it. And we put the links on. Another, you know, if your student has needs some very special testing, ACT a lot of times will actually allow your child to be tested in their school or a special testing location versus their national sites. When it says national, it's kind of like one high school where a large area will go for their ACT testing, but you can actually get accommodations if approved to be tested in your home school during a certain window. Next slide. So what comes after you take your college boards is you go through the college application process. So this is, let's just go through it. So can a college ask about, are you in good health? Have you been hospitalized in the past 5 years? Absolutely not. A college cannot ask about a disability in any way, shape, or form. Conversely, though, when you are in college, it does, the burden falls on the student to share if they want any accommodation. So when you're in high school or when you're in public school from 3 to 21, 3 to 18, the burden of child find is actually on the school district. However, when you're in college, they don't have to go and identify that. It's up to the student to seek assistance. And it's not even the parents, even though you may be writing the check. It is up to the student to advocate for themselves when they're in. Now, with that being said, it is a personal choice about whether you disclose if you had a medical issue, if you have an IEP, if you have a 504. Many students do choose to write about their transplant journey in their college essay, or even through the activities that they're involved in, if they're a speaker for Donate Life or something like that. It can be kind of insinuate, you know, in their who they are. I will tell you a funny story. On the child study team, one of my colleagues, when I first told her that my son was going to need a kidney transplant, she said to me, well, that's going to make a great college essay. So that was her, you know, first thing out of her mouth. And we just laughed. So, everyone, it's an individual choice. It cannot be held against you. But I come from the school of thinking that, you know, it is who you are, and it's part of your journey, and you have every right to share it. But again, it's a personal choice, and they cannot hold it against you. just want to clarify a little bit about that. They can ask, are you healthy enough to perform certain activities? Like if you were applying to a physical therapy program, they'll ask, you know, are you able to carry 25 pounds or something like that with reasonable accommodations? That is permissible, but they aren't allowed to ask what we highlighted in yellow. Next slide, please. And college life. I'm very lucky to have a relative who was a resident life director at a four-year university. So I picked her brain, and I knew about this as well. All public colleges and most privates have Office of Student Services. They call them something different. There's not a universal name. Some have like Office of Disability Services, Office of Student Services, some version of that title. And that's the office that determines eligibility for academic, housing, or dining accommodations. Again, you have to apply to them. You need to reach out to them. There are links on all the college websites of how to find it. But I thought was really interesting in thinking through the lens of someone with a transplant, what are some of the accommodations that could be appropriate? So, and then asking my aunt, you know, what were some of the accommodations she's received as a resident life director? So some of the things were like a service dog, special floor assignments, specialized training for the resident directors or resident assistants, obviously air conditioning, because even in today's world, there are dorms without air conditioning, private bathrooms, having a single room, obviously for germs and things like that, being assigned to a building that's close to your classes, if fatigue's a factor. She said she was a liaison with the food services, so any kind of special dietary issues, that's something that is something that you can ask for and be accommodated for, a preferential schedule, again, if fatigue or you have to do labs in the morning or whatever the case may be, you know, maybe getting first shot at scheduling so that you're not stuck with the 8 a.m., you know, courses. The other thing is for the academic, when you're in college, our students need to self-advocate, but they have to self-identify, like I said before. The accommodations are requested by the student, and professors do expect students to initiate the request. So even though, you know, we are the parents and again, writing the checks, it's the students that have to self-advocate. And I know that's a huge part of transition that we're dealing with right now, right? Preparing our students to transition from pediatric care to adult medical care. The same goes for college as well. Next slide.
Leslie, I just want to break in for a minute and tell you have 5 minutes, okay?
Thank you, yes. Yep. So these are our takeaway tips that we hope that you take away. That states have different regulations, but there is a federal law and that minimal services are available. Do not hesitate to ask schools for help with your child with a transplant at any age. So maybe things were going along great, or, you know, you were in a very small little elementary school and now you're in a big middle school or in a big high school. At any time along the journey, ask for help. Documentation is key. We kind of put a plug in for our transplant team, and I think there are some transplant center social workers and docs on the call. They've probably written hundreds of letters to support, you know, our transplanted children, and they probably can even give us some ideas, but they're the people that will help write letters and tell our educational institutions what our children need. Every transplant child is unique. Just remember the PE example I gave you. So, you know, think in the lens, you need to look at each child individually. The other part is a lot of times we only just think about grades, but schools really, especially coming out of COVID, social and emotional functioning. Even the huge CARES Act is funding all kinds of mental health services. So it's not just, well, my kid's a really good student and they get really good grades, so therefore your child has a transplant and that means something and they may need help somewhere. You may need help somewhere. So it's okay to advocate for your child. It's a whole child. And schools have to have whole child people, not just, you know, we're looking at the learning. There are social workers, there's psychologists, there's counselors, because we know that for kids to make the most growth, we need to look at the child as a whole. And the last part is it's a partnership. And I know it can be hard and scary and frustrating. And here I am, I've been on both sides of the table, so to speak, right? I have learned in my wisdom is that it's a partnership. So working together with the attitude of cooperation will be best for your child. And I think, and we've talked about it, and I want to really throw it out there, we're a rare breed, right? There's not a lot of pediatric transplants. Like, there's a ton of kids diagnosed with ADHD. There's a ton of kids with other with specific learning disabilities. But pediatric transplants, even though we're here today, we're pretty rare. And we sometimes have to help the districts know what our child is entitled to. And that's okay. I've had to do it. I've been in very large districts where there were, you know, I've worked for 20 years and never had a child with a transplant that I worked with professionally. In my town, my two kids are the only two kids with transplants. So, you know, please don't get mad at your district if they don't know, but, you know, it doesn't mean that you aren't entitled to services. Next slide. This, when elephants fight, it is the grass that suffers. So if you are frustrated with your school, try to remember it's not an ego thing. And this was actually in the conference room at one of my school districts from a very great principal of mine who has since passed. But I think it goes without saying, right? The grass is our children. So if we can just figure out how to work cooperatively, I think everyone really grows from that. Next slide. So I think if you need to reach us, we are all very willing to hear from you. So this is our contact information, and I'll let Ansara take over from here.
We had a lot of really great questions that we will get back to you. We're going to consolidate those questions and send out the answers later on. But we did have one that I think we should, it was the most voted question, asked about, trying to find it.
I can see it. It's about ADHD, okay. I think.
Yes,
and
please.
And yes, that answer is that yes, the prevalence of ADHD diagnosis in transplant recipients is higher than the general population. I know a study quite a while back released by the NIH was that about 30% of transplant recipients are diagnosed with ADHD. So I know there's another session coming up right here at 3 o'clock about executive functioning. And I'd really, really encourage you to go hop on that and ask those psychologists about why that might be. But yes, you're very right. It is more prevalent in, especially when they compared siblings of the same family, it is more prevalent.
Great. And I don't know if you would like to show the resource links that the last two slides. Brandon, can you show the next slide? If he's still there. Another question we had was, we have maybe 1 minute left. So whenever my child's 504 doesn't get followed, the school asks why my child didn't speak up for himself. He's 16. Is this common? It's hard for him to do so. Who needs to be accountable in this situation?
So you have to have there has to be a 504 coordinator. That's mandated. So it can be the building principal. It can be a school counselor. It may be the teacher, depending on what your state is. That's very frustrating to hear. I hear it a lot, even about my own, you know, children. And as a supervisor, it kills me when teachers say that as well. But there has to be a 504 coordinator, and that's who I would address your question to, and say, you know what, that's, you make a great point. How are we going to help him? How are we going to help him with that goal? It's not going to come innately. It's got to be taught. So how are we going to partner to help him increase his self-advocacy? So.
Great. I really want to thank you for all this incredible information. It was really helpful. Here's some more resources here. This is all going to be recorded and shared with all of the participants later on, I think next week. So thank you so much to our speakers for your time today and all of your knowledge. And please attend the next session.
for those of you who have further questions, I'm going to hop over to one of the networking booths. Is there a certain number we're supposed to go to if people have follow-up questions?
I don't know. I think there's the networking up above. There's networking. Mm-hmm. You can go there. I'm not sure about a certain
Yeah, I'm number. Happy to go where you go, Regan, if you want. We can kind of tag team.
Okay.
That'd I can be go great. To the networking one for about 20 minutes, too, and answer any questions.
Which one do you want to go? Pick a number. Is there a special number?
There's three of us. Let's go to three.
There you go. We'll go to network three. All right.
See you guys. Thank you, everyone, for attending.